Hello and welcome to Health Professional Radio. I'm your host, Neil Howard. Iodine's main role is to help manufacture thyroid hormones. So says our guest in studio today, returning Dr. Jacob Teitelbaum. He's the director of the Practitioners Alliance Network, one of the most frequently quoted integrative medical authorities in the country, and also the lead author of 4 studies on effective treatment of fibromyalgia and chronic fatigue syndrome. Also a study on effective treatment of autism using NAET. Now, Dr. Teitelbaum also appears often as a guest on news and talk shows nationwide, including Good Morning America, Dr. Oz, Oprah and Friends, CNN, Fox News, Health, and now here with us today on Health Professional Radio. How are you doing today, Dr. Teitelbaum?
I'm Neil, doing great. A pleasure to be with you.
Thank you so much. When we're talking about hypothyroidism or hyperthyroidism, the thyroid in general, as it relates to overall good health, supplements, iodine being at a 50% reduction in intake over the past 30 years, where are we going to get the iodine and any of the other minerals that we need? And, you know, it's not coming from our food, that's for sure.
Absolutely, Neil. And unfortunately, the American diet has been ravaged by food processing. Mm-hmm. If you look at it, the data shows that the average American has about 140 to 150 pounds of sugar added to their diet each year in food processing. That's 18% of our calories. Another 18% of our calories come from white flour, which have been essentially so raped in terms of nutritional support that the government mandated that they put a tiny, tiny bit of the nutrients back in, which they cynically call enriched flour. You know, so it should be mildly raped flour.
Mildly.
Maybe not as severely raped, only pillaged flour instead of totally white. So we've lost another 18% of our calories with that. Added fats, the effects of each step of food processing generally strips out more nutrients. We've lost over 50% of the vitamins and minerals that were present in the normal food supply over 100 years ago. They're not present. And this is why this is the first time in human history you see people routinely being both obese and malnourished at the same time. So it's no longer become feasible for most people to get all of the vitamins and minerals they need by simply eating the diet. Mm-hmm. It's too wiped out for the processing. And it's something that I think this is a good common sense measure. It's a good idea for people to take a good solid multivitamin. Now, it's important to distinguish between the daily allowance, the recommended daily amounts, which often are based on what amount is needed to prevent, say, for vitamin C. They took at what's needed to prevent scurvy, and then they added a margin of safety for that. Mm-hmm. But most of these do not look at what's needed to optimize function. So I prefer recommended intakes based on what optimizes function. And a good multivitamin, the one that I like to use for people is a vitamin powder called the Energy Revitalization System vitamin powder. One drink replaces pretty much everything from A to Z.
You said one drink. Now, a moment ago, you mentioned recommending taking a good solid multivitamin. Now, I just want to clarify, are you talking about solid as in pill form or liquid, or are you talking about a well-rounded regimen of multivitamins?
Good solid in terms of having optimal levels.
Okay.
The vitamin is that I like to use is a powder, and then you just add water.
Okay.
So it starts as a solid and goes to liquid. So it's a vitamin powder. And you can get one called the Daily Energy Infusion. It's another very good one. For those who don't like powders, there's a My Favorite Multiple Dash Take One. It's a good one a day. Mm-hmm. A pill that people can take. There's a number of good ones. Most are not, in my opinion.
My naivete will shine right now. It seems as though if companies are making supplements and companies are taking nutrients out of food, and then companies are making drugs to deal with thyroid problems and whatnot, why not just put the nutrients back into the food and be done with it?
Well, if you look at, for example, our First Lady did a thing trying to get children to learn about the value of eating foods that were less processed, such as vegetables. And the food companies cut her off at the knees. So who's going to go out there and say this? And, you know, look at the advertising. If you look at the biggest advertiser in the country, it's basically processed foods and related items. You have that, and then you have cosmetics. And then you have the drug companies. So these are the biggest advertisers. Now, I know that I work with the media, and the editors well and truly do not want to tick off their advertisers. If a reporter submits a story that will upset an advertiser, like a processed food company or a pharmaceutical company, they will find it quietly buried. And if the reporter pushes, the reporter will find themselves quietly buried.
Quietly buried.
And you'll see that, and this was a surprise to me, but speaking with editors of major magazines, when they take advertisements for many of the drugs, such as the ibuprofen type things like that, they often come, the contract comes with a clause stating that that magazine is not allowed to run anything favorable on natural medicine in that issue.
Is that, well, that's good to know.
And most magazines will take that advertising because it's big money. So when you say, well, gee, why doesn't the media talk about it? Why doesn't our Congress, who is on basically to get elected, we require them to take massive bribes from these folks, from food processors and pharmaceutical industry, and then they come back and make laws. Do you realize that many states passed laws that it would be illegal for anybody, including a doctor, to counsel people on nutrition unless they were basically certified by what used to be the ADA, which is basically, if you look at the ADA, the American Dietetic Association, they've taken a new name, but it's the same group. Most of the conferences are sponsored by Coke, Pepsi, Nestle, by the food processors. So basically, they were trying to get laws pursued at anybody who was not trained by the Nestle and Coca-Cola, basically, in nutrition, would not be allowed to talk about nutrition.
That's pretty sinister, if you ask me.
Well, no, it's good business.
Well, yeah, so, them, but not for us.
But it's not about us, Neil.
But aren't these CEOs and company heads eating the same foods that we are? Or do they have special food that gives them the things that they need?
No, I think that basically they've talked themselves into believing what they're saying. I suspect the whoever owns Coca-Cola drinks Coke, or at least Diet Coke.
Yeah.
And, you know, I'm not against having, I mean, I go to a movie, you'll see me there in the front row with a big popcorn and a large Diet Coke. Yeah. You know, I'm not against people living and enjoying themselves. I just want them to have the nutritional support. It's a basic insurance policy. It's just common sense. And it's funny, some people say, well, you take the B vitamins in and you pee them out, and therefore you're just making expensive urine, so you shouldn't have it. And, you know, I recommend for those people who say that, they're right, don't drink water. You just pee it out. Don't breathe air. You're just going to exhale it.
Yeah, why do anything that's beneficial at all if it's not going to be beneficial right now immediately, right?
Well, it's a silliness. I mean, you know, the argument, which is a good one, is we didn't need any multivitamins 500 years ago. Why do we suddenly need them? And that's a really good argument if there was not a change in the diet. But we have lost over 50% of our nutrients, vitamins, minerals, cofactors, through food processing. And there wasn't much more than a 10 to 20% margin of safety and excess to begin with. So most Americans are not getting optimal amounts. And you look at data out of USDA and others, most diets are not getting even the zinc and the copper and just basic nutrients they need. And each of these results in a decrease in function. For example, we look at medicine. 31% of Americans suffer with chronic severe fatigue. One-third of Americans suffer with pain that they find inadequately treated. And a lot of these, both of these relate to the human energy crisis. You don't have enough nutritional support, enough energy, you're going to be tired. But for pain, most pain is muscle pain, which as physicians, we're really not taught much about. Taught to throw muscle relaxants out of maybe. But muscles pain, muscles shorten when they don't have enough energy. Muscles are like a spring. It takes more energy to stretch the muscle than to contract it. So think about that for a moment. You have a spring. You want to stretch that out, it takes energy. The muscle, you want to release and relax the muscle, takes the energy. And when you look at the the actinomycin and the energy it takes for those, you'll see. I mean, it's a funny thing. It takes less energy for the muscle to be stay contracted. That's why after you've had a hard workout, you come home and you don't say, honey, my muscles are all loose and limp. You see, they're all tight. And when you don't have enough energy, muscles get locked in a short position. And after a couple of weeks or years of that, they start to hurt. And that's why low energy is a major cause for muscle pain, which arguably is the most common cause of pain that muscle most pain. People have. And by, and as physicians, we're not even trained to do a proper exam for muscle pain. We don't know how to treat it. It's not a surprise that people stay in chronic pain. So you'll see that when you give people a good multivitamin, I'm not talking about your standard ones you're going to get at most, you know, supermarkets. Mm-hmm. So you really do not have enough, but at least 50 milligrams of each of the B vitamins, for example, you'll see that their pain and fatigue after about 6 weeks will often go away.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk about your book. I think it's your one of your latest works, the Fatigue and Fibromyalgia book. What prompted you to become an author after, you know, being in the medical profession for so long?
Well, I got into the CL fast and you know, I had it. I came down with what I call the drop-dead flu when I was in medical school. Uh-huh. And it actually, I had chronic fatigue syndrome, fibromyalgia. It actually knocked me out of medical school. And since I was paying my own way, my dad was dead. And I had no more work study and no more loans. I was homeless, sleeping in parks. So it caught my attention. And I was able to learn what I needed. It was funny. It was as if the universe put a homeless medical school sign on my park bench. And all these different doctors and other people came by, and they taught me bits and pieces of what I needed. And I was able to get myself well and go back to med school and did great. I have spent the last 35 years researching this area. And to create effective treatment for people with fibromyalgia, again, we've published a double-blind research on this. If you treat with what you call the SHINE protocol, sleep, hormonal support, infections, nutritional support, and exercise is able, 91% of people with fibromyalgia will improve. And what we have is actually a free energy analysis program. People can go to endfatigue.com. For those listening, if you have a patient who has fibromyalgia or chronic fatigue, endfatigue.com, have them do the free energy analysis program, and it will tell them what things they need to do to optimize energy production, including everything from looking for sleep apnea and restless leg syndrome, hormonal problems, a host of other things.
Now, you're the developer of an app, the Cures A to Z app. It's a free app for smartphones. Talk about that app briefly.
Well, it basically, I'm a science geek, and I read the medical literature for fun. I was blessed that the universe gave me a wife that, instead of being attracted to some reason to sports and cars, was attracted to science geeks. So I'm lucky.
Lucky for you, yeah.
Indeed. And so I have taken those tens of thousands of studies and put together the nuts and bolts in a nice, simple thing, and looking up everything from acne to zoster, A to Z, high blood pressure, whatever it happens to be. You look it up, and it'll say, here's what the research suggests can be helpful using natural things, and it'll look at some of the medications. There's some that I'll give a very big thumbs up, and some they'll say, these are basically scams. And I don't get paid from either side. I won't take money from either the drug companies or the pharmaceutical industry or the natural products industry. And my royalties and things I assign, I'll go to charity. So it allows me to get an objective, good, solid thing of, okay, what really helps and what doesn't. It separates the wheat from the chaff for people and does so very easily for both practitioners and for the public.
Great, great. You've been listening to Health Professional Radio. I'm your host, Neil Howard. It's been a pleasure this afternoon speaking with Dr. Jacob Teitelbaum about iodine supplements, supplements in general, the fact that we didn't need them 500 years ago, but, of course, we need them now, and talking about the importance of paying more attention to the minerals and supplements that we are taking in order to facilitate good health. It's been great having you here with us today, Doctor.
Yeah, a pleasure.
Transcripts and audio of this program are available at healthprofessionalradio.com.au and also at hpr.fm, and you can subscribe to our podcast on iTunes.